say that the Lord is mad. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let's come into his presence with singing and thanksgiving in our hearts as we call upon his name. Come on, let's lift this up together.
We've waited for this day. We're gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth.
You're the reason.
It's the real. table for me.
There's a place for me, and it's heavenly.
At the table.
At the table with the King.
He says, be seated in heavenly places.
There's a place for me.
Oh, yeah.
And it's heavenly.
At the table.
At the table.
At the table.
At the table with the King.
It's the real thing. Woo! If you know he's the real thing, lift your hands and open your mouth and give God an honorable praise.
Thanks, Kim, for leading us in that. And church, I miss calling you forward to read scriptures. I know that that's going to happen soon, but I really wanted it to happen this weekend. So I invited some of our campus pastors and our staff to come forward and read scriptures about God's word over us. There's nothing in our worship time better than just hearing the word of God and the power of the word of God spoken into our homes, the places that we're engaging the Lord with right now. But I also want you to engage with us as well by finding a scripture that speaks about God's love and putting it in the chat box as you engage with this service. And as you do that, let's listen to these scriptures. Let's receive the word of the Lord into our hearts. Sherry, you can start first. Go ahead.
Psalm 100, verse 5. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations.
A familiar reminder from John 3, verses 16 and 17. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him.
Romans 5:8. But God shows his love for us in that even while we were still sinners, Christ died for us.
Yes. Amen. 1 John 4:7-10. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God. And whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. In this, the love of God was made manifest among us. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins.
Psalm 59:16, but I will sing of your strength. I will sing aloud of your steadfast love in the morning, for you have been to me a fortress and a refuge in the day of my distress. O my strength, I will sing praise to you, for you, O God, are my fortress, the God who shows me steadfast love.
His body bound. by heavy storm, Messiah still and all.
We have a song of praise. Come on, stand up and sing.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God.
That's right, sing it. Praise His name.
You, but I feel welcome. And if you don't, let me be the first to say to you, welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel. My name is Ed Ollie, and I'm the lead campus pastor. We're going to keep the atmosphere of worship just flowing in this place. Maybe you're a guest, and this is the first time that you've tuned in, or maybe it's the 28th time. We love guests, and every weekend is someone's first weekend at Harvest Bible Chapel, and so we say welcome. Maybe you're here and you're part of our church. There's a check-in button that's right at the top of the screen. Would you go ahead and let us know that you're here? And if you're one of our guests, let's have a little fun this weekend. And in the chat box, let us know where you're viewing from right now. We love to celebrate with you. A couple things I want to remind you of and make you aware of on this weekend. If you're a part of our church, you already know how to give. There's multiple ways that we have, whether it's electronic or sending it in the mail. But there's something that I want to remind you of. 1 Corinthians 9, verse 7 says that any person that gives, they should do so out of the goodness of their heart. That you should not do it under compulsion, because God loves a cheerful giver. So here's the deal. If you're a guest, this is the only part of the service that wasn't created for you. We believe that God has something for you today, and we don't want anything from you. But if you're a part of our church, we love to give. And in this time and in this season where sometimes it's so challenging to be cheerful, we want you to give with a cheerful heart. We have some members that have joined us during this period of time since we've been away, that God is still on the move. He's still adding to our church. And on the screen right now, there are over 25 names of families that are there that have joined our church. We want to say welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel. Be in prayer for these families. And as always, if there's anything that you want to share with us or know that might impede anyone from being a member of good standing, you can touch base with your campus pastor. Speaking of campus pastors, we're going to be blessed in a few minutes. Dave Learned is going to be bringing the Word of God. Pastor Dave is at the Rolling Meadows campus. He's been serving the Lord faithfully at Harvest Bible Chapel for 21 years, and he has a powerful word for you, and I can't wait to be able to join in. We've been praying, and as a church, we believe very strongly about the power of prayer. We believe that prayer doesn't just change things, it changes us. And so I want to remind you of some things that have just happened. We want to share some prayer requests that have come in this week and then share with you a couple answered prayers. This is Angelina from Elgin. She wanted prayer for her two brothers to search for the truth. May the Holy Spirit lead them to the Bible and Jesus Christ to be their Lord and Savior. I think we can all agree with that. Susan from the Aurora campus, she let us know that she would love prayer because she's been diagnosed with breast cancer. Susan, we're standing with you and praying with you. Quentin from Rolling Meadows, he said, I am overwhelmed by my responsibilities at work. Please pray for peace in my soul and that I would find God to be trustworthy, believing in his promises. I don't know about you, but maybe you have found God to be trustworthy, and we could pray for Quentin this week. And then from Brenda, from the Rolling Meadows campus. Please pray for my sister who has COVID and for my mom who's suffering from depression and anxiety. Pray for our country and that we would all be united as one. Well, those are just a few of the prayer requests, but you may be wondering what God has done through some of the prayer requests that have come in. Well, I want to share with you two quick stories of God's blessing in prayer. Anthony said, please give God thanks for the answered prayers this week. And then also John from Rolling Meadows said, my brother had skin cancer removed from his heel on July 6th. He received a lab result today. Church, the result of that lab result is that his cancer is gone. He is negative. There is no cancer in his body. And he's giving God thanks for the many prayers that have come. And in our campus pastor meeting this week, Pastor Britt shared a story of someone who was recently baptized, and he invited him to dinner. As they sat for dinner, he shared with his family how the Lord Jesus had given him hope. His father, who was not a Christian, asked him, how did this happen? And he began to share the story of how his life has been transformed. And right there at the dinner table, his father said yes to Jesus Christ. I don't know about you, but I'm excited. I don't want to just talk about prayer, but I want to pray right now. So if you would, bow your heads with me as I go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your power, that you're more than enough. That while we were late to our own salvation, that you were there standing. You are our healer. You are our deliverer. And God, we ask that you would be with us, be with our church this week as we pray that you are more than enough. Let's worship the Lord Jesus together.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore. For endless days we will sing Your praise. Oh, Lord. Oh, Lord our God.
Let's sing that again.
Worship the Lord Jesus Christ. Can I just say to everybody, the Spirit of the Lord is present, and we're listening to Him, and we're responding to Him, and we're so grateful for the chance to worship together in this day. We get the privilege today of opening God's Word. We get the privilege of turning again to the Gospel of Mark. We've been at this a little while now, and the Lord continues to lead us. He continues to teach us, and we're here to listen. We're here to receive. We are turning a corner today in Mark chapter 14 because for the last 3 weeks, we spent time on the sermon that Jesus gave on the Mount of Olives. And in that, Pastor Dave Stone and Pastor Jeff Thompson led us so well to think about the period of tribulation, to think about the second coming of Jesus Christ, and most of all, to think about, are we awake? Are we alert? Are we ready? And that, my goodness, three powerful parts within Mark chapter 13. What changes now is this. We go back to the story, and Jesus' extended teaching is done in the Gospel of Mark, and now the timeline's going to move, and it's going to move quick. We're going to quickly, in these last three chapters, read and be reminded about how Jesus, well, He's going to be arrested, He's going to be crucified, buried, and the hope for all of us, resurrected. That's all coming. But right in between, we've got this spot. We've been learning so much in Mark. Jesus, remember, He has all authority. We spent some time thinking about His power over nature, His power over sickness, even His power over death. We spent time thinking about how He's our radical teacher. He was upsetting a lot of people, particularly the religious leaders. We'll talk about them in a second, with His teaching. And He was a bold servant. Jesus didn't come to be served. He came to serve and to give His life as a ransom for many. So within the context of that, now we're into this stage, this portion of the book that we're labeled the Suffering King. And we want to lean into God's Word today. Like I said, we're shifting gears, but can I just encourage you with this? What God has planned, predicted, and promised will come to pass in His time and in His way. You can count on that. God has revealed His plan so carefully and so consistently throughout His Word so that we can be ready and know this. God's revelation of hope and salvation through Jesus requires a response. Let me say that again. God's revelation of hope and salvation through Jesus requires a response. The title of the message today is this, Response Required. You know, there's just certain things that need a response. Do you know that? There's just certain things that require a response. Here's one, a fire alarm. Time to get up. Better respond to that. Here's one. You better respond to this. You have a job offer. Don't sleep on that. Here's one I'm particularly fond of, free food. You need to respond. There's just certain things you got to respond to. And maybe this is too soon. You can tell me. An IRS filing deadline. You better respond. Okay, sorry. Sorry to bring that all up again. It got me thinking about this. It got me thinking about these four letters we use sometimes. Do you know these letters? RSVP. Have you ever used those? What in the world? I had to go to, I call it the Google, to find out what that was. And RSVP, do you know? That is a phrase that originates in the French language. Now, I got to be honest. Most of my French relates to French fries, a French press, or maybe a French silk pie. So I'm not a scholar here. But in French, RSVP actually says, I'm trying to debate to say this or not. I'm just going to go for it. You can send your letters to me later, okay? It stands for this. Répondez, s'il vous plaît. That's the last time you'll ever hear me say that. But that's kind of cool because RSVP means something. Respond, please. You get the evite. You get the text. You get the letter, and it needs a response. I think in Chicago, we're not quite that sophisticated. We just say stuff like, hey, you coming? You know, that's how we respond to each other. The simple idea is this. If you've been invited, if someone took the particular time and attention to invite you, a response is required. And as we look at God's word today, that's the simple idea that we see three times in these verses. A response is required. Three different responses in the verses we're going to look at together today. Sadly, two of them are a resounding no in response to Jesus, and it is tragic. One of them, though, is a beautiful and faith-stirring yes, and we're going to look at that together today. Our focus today is this, to learn, to consider, and to respond to Jesus personally. The imminent return of Jesus requires a personal response from me and from you. Let's pray together. Let's invite the Lord to lead us. Heavenly Father, in this time, we invite your Spirit to bring your word to our heart. I thank you, Lord, that you tell us the Bible is living and active. It accomplishes the purpose for which it is sent. So, Lord, have your way today, please. We pray all these things together in Jesus' name. Amen. So three responses to Jesus. A response is required. We're going to see them quickly in the text. They're going to come right at us. We're in Mark chapter 14, starting in verse 1. And I want to read the first couple of verses as we begin now. It was now 2 days before the Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And the chief priests and the scribes were seeking how to arrest him, that's Jesus, by stealth and kill him. Wow, the storyline is advancing. For they said, not during the feast, lest there be an uproar from the people. Now, instead of points, I'm going to give you three responses. And so if you're taking notes, here's the first one. Response number one, total rejection. I'm 100%. Out on Jesus. Wow, that's even hard to say, let alone to have that be the reality of what's going on here. But that is the reality of what's going on here. Now, let's just look at the verses here for a minute. 2 days before the Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread. What is happening here? Well, this is the annual Jewish holiday celebration, remembrance of God's faithfulness to his people through the Passover. And in it, there's an opportunity for all who were Jewish to gather, to feast, to remember, to celebrate. God is faithful to his people. However, the chief priests and the scribes had something else on their mind. What is it? Well, they're seeking the opportunity to arrest him and kill him. Wow. Now, you got to know, it's been happening throughout Mark. It happens throughout the Gospels. Jesus has a lot to say to these chief priests and to the scribes. Why? Because their focus was to, in every way possible, maintain a system of external conformity to a set of rules while completely neglecting the reality of what was happening in their hearts. Not only that did they do that personally, but they propagated that so that others were called to the same. And if Jesus is going to go hard after anything, it is that. A system that would propagate confidence in self-righteous activity instead of recognizing how greatly we need forgiveness, how greatly we need the Lord, and turning fully to Jesus as the Savior. So there was a thing going on. They were back and forth, and apparently, sadly, the chief priests, the scribes, had had enough. But it's interesting. They kind of are very mannerly in their desire to murder. I don't know how that goes together. They were seeking how to arrest him by stealth and kill him. For they said, not during the feast, lest there be an uproar from the people. How in the world? How do you have a heart that says it's time to murder that person, but say, hey, be careful of your public image. Don't do it at the wrong time. Don't stir people up too much. Here's the thing. The chief priests and the scribes didn't want to cause a stir. They were more afraid of man than they were afraid of God. They did not have the fear of the Lord. They did have a fear of man. And you got to know, at Passover, the normal population of Jerusalem, which would have been around 100,000, could swell to 300,000 to 400,000 people, many of whom coming even from Galilee, where Jesus had taught and healed, and they just did not want to make a scene that would cause a problem for them. But the truth of it is this, they were 100% out on Jesus. They knew about the miracles. They had heard his teachings. At the end of the day, they rejected it because for them to receive what Jesus was saying would upset everything they had committed themselves to. It would upset their traditions. It would upset their places of authority and control. It might even upset their ability to maintain the jobs or careers that they have. Which just leads me to say this. You got to know, there's always a cost to following Jesus. When I choose to surrender to him, I submit everything to him. Sadly, these priests, these scribes were unwilling to do that. Instead, they rejected him. They placed judgment upon him. And in time, they did carry out their desire to murder Jesus. We got to learn from this, loved ones, that at the core of what was happening with the chief priests and the scribes is this, a heightened fear of man, which, by the way, God's word says, Proverbs 29, the fear of man brings a snare, but he who trusts in the Lord will be exalted. I love that. They had this fear of man. What they did not have was this. Proverbs 1:7 says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. Total rejection comes when we elevate the view of man and what man considers, and we relegate God's perspective to nothing. They didn't want to hear what Jesus had to say because it was going to confront what they were thinking and doing too much, and sadly, response of theirs is total rejection. It's clear, and it's tragic. Now, I'm thankful that there's more to this passage, because if that's all I had to say today, oh man, that's hard to hear. But Mark purposely sandwiches two tragic stories of rejection around one beautiful picture of a woman giving honor to Jesus. Let's keep reading. Mark chapter 14, verse 3. While he was at Bethany, Jesus was at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, as he was reclining at table, a woman came with an alabaster flask of ointment, of pure nard, very costly. And she broke the flask and poured it over his head. Okay, check this out. Here's what's happening. There's a feast, there's friends, there's a host. His name is Simon. Interesting subtitle, Simon the leper. Now, here's what I know about leprosy. In the first century, it was a ticket to isolation. It was contagious, it was feared, it was life-threatening, and if you had leprosy, you weren't hanging out with anybody. So I'm pretty certain that this wasn't a current state of Simon having leprosy. This is a description to distinguish Simon from other times when other Simons are referenced in the Gospels. But how is he referenced? Simon the leper. The Bible does not say this, but Jesus healed lepers, and I wonder if he healed Simon. He's hosting a party, he's inviting Jesus' followers, and he's got a story to tell. I don't know. The Lord knows. I'm going to ask that someday. But here's Simon at the party. He's hosting at his home. Very likely at the table was a man named Lazarus. He was from Bethany. That's where Mary and Martha and Lazarus were from. You ever go to a party and you're like, man, that person keeps telling better stories than I have? I mean, Simon might be like, well, I used to have leprosy. Now I don't anymore. Lazarus is like, yeah, well, I used to be dead. And then Jesus raised me from the dead. Oh, man. I want to hear those stories for sure. I do wonder what that conversation was like. But in the midst of it, here's Mary. Now, this is Mary, the sister of Lazarus. And she's a part of the scene, and she's there, and she does the most amazing thing. She doesn't talk, she doesn't announce her plans, but she does something. Well, let's just read it again. A woman came with an alabaster flask of ointment of pure nard, very costly, and she broke the flask and poured it over his head. I don't know exactly what Mary was thinking, but I'm thinking it is along these lines. Jesus is powerful. Jesus is loving and compassionate. Jesus is real. Jesus is who he said he was. I have full confidence Mary believed Jesus to be who he said he was, the coming Messiah promised by God long, long before. He's the real deal. He's their only hope. I believe in who he says he is. I've witnessed the miracles. My brother was dead, and now he's alive. And I think Mary had maybe this thought in her mind. Right here, right now, he's here. I have the opportunity to express my gratitude. I have the opportunity to express devotion. I have the opportunity to give him the praise, to give him the glory that I believe he's due. And I'm going for it. It doesn't say that in the text. I just feel like that's what happened. Right here, right now, she brings this alabaster flask of ointment. I had to figure that out. I didn't know what that meant. Let me show you a picture. This is what a flask probably looked like in first century Jerusalem. And it was made out of kind of alabaster, which is almost like a little marble, a thin marble thing. It was very costly. The text says three or four times. It's costly. It's precious. Quite possibly passed down to her from her mother or others. Now, Mary didn't come with this ointment, with this perfume, like would have been the tradition with a dab or with a dot. What did she do? She broke open the flask such that it could be poured upon Jesus. It was customary to anoint with a drop or two of oil. It was a welcome. It was a blessing. But she wasn't doing that. She was bringing everything she had, costly, and giving it to honor Jesus, to respond to him. I got a question for you. How much strong perfume is needed to get the job done? I realize this is a varied debate. Different people have different feelings about this. But I'll just say not much. A drop, a two, a spritz, that's great. She brought everything she had, and she gave it because she wanted to bless Jesus, because she wanted to respond to Jesus. She saw him with clarity, and she was making her statement. I believe who he says he is. I choose to follow him. I want to honor him. And when we do that, it changes everything. Jesus himself taught us, where your treasure is, there your heart is also. Now, it's interesting. How do we know the price, the value of this ointment? Well, it actually comes out through the disciples' words. Just a quick note. Did you catch Mary's speech she gave when she did this? Not a word. Her actions spoke so loudly. That does not mean that no one had something to say. And here's what we hear from the disciples. Verse 4, There were some who said to themselves indignantly, now let me just pause there for a second. This is the Gospel of Mark. If you go to John chapter 12, we're not going to do that tonight, the same story is told, and there's more detail to this. And in there, it's very clear that, yes, the disciples questioned this decision, but very specifically, Judas questioned this decision. Interestingly, in John, you can see that Judas was the one who knew the price of this possession she had just lavished upon Jesus. I think we'll learn more about that in a couple of minutes. But I don't think Mary was asking the question, how much does this cost? I think she was asking the question, how much can I give honor to Jesus? And that's the question that has to come to all of us. You know what's really fascinating to me? Mark 13 is the whole Olivet Discourse, the teaching of Jesus. But if you go just before that in the timeline of this story, do you know what you find? You find a widow giving a gift in front of some rich people, giving an offering. She put in two small coins. And Jesus said, this poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to the offering box, for they contribute out of their abundance, but she, out of her poverty, has put in everything she had, all that she had to live on. You know what I love about that? Both of those things, I don't think the Lord is concerned with the amount, but he is concerned with the heart. And here's the widow with the two coins. I gave it all. And here's Mary with this beautiful possession of alabaster nard perfume. I gave it all. I gave everything I could give. What a great thing. Let that be true of us, that when we see Jesus, when we learn of Jesus, that we respond to him and say, Lord, you're worthy of it all. There's nothing I would want to hold back. But sadly, Judas had calculated the value. He said it was a wasteful decision. The disciples are like, what are you doing? And I got to be honest, if I pulled a move like that, I think my wife would be like, do you know what that was worth? I think my friends might be like, are you really going to do that? 300 denarii is 300 days' wages. So think, how much income can you earn between today and the middle of May 2021? That's a big number to pour out. And that's exactly what Mary did, because she saw Jesus for who he was. And look at what Jesus said. Well, first of all, this ointment could have been sold for more than 300 denarii and given to the poor, and they scolded her. Mary, what are you doing? Jesus has something to say too. And he says, leave her alone. Why do you trouble her? She's done a beautiful thing to me, for you always have the poor with you, and whenever you want, you can do good for them, but you will not always have me. She has done what she could. Wow. Now, just a quick thing. Jesus models, Jesus teaches generosity to people in need. He has compassion for the poor and for the broken and the hurting. That's not what's in play here. What's in play here is a timing thing. Yes, you could have spent the money in another way, but this is the opportunity you have to respond to Jesus, Mary. You made a great decision because you're not going to have me always. In fact, this timeline's going to pick up here these next few chapters. A lot's going to happen, and this probably likely was Mary's last opportunity to respond personally to Jesus. It's beautiful, Jesus says. I read this quote by Charles Spurgeon. Let me just read it. I can't say this better than this. Nothing puts life into men like a dying Savior. Get you close to Christ and carry the remembrance of him about you from day to day, and you will do right royal deeds. Come, let us slay sin, for Christ was slain. Come, let us bury all of our pride, for Christ was buried. Come, let us rise to newness of life, for Christ has risen. Let us be united with our crucified Lord in his one great object. Let us live and die with him, and then every action of our lives will be very beautiful. Honoring Jesus is right. Honoring Jesus is beautiful. Responding to his invitation, his clarification of who he is a beautiful thing. Our actions reveal the reality of what's going on in our heart. And Mary saw, she perceived, and she said, I want to bless Jesus. I want to respond to him with love and honor. God always looks at the heart revealed through our actions. Lord, lead me and lead us to be people who bring acts of worship, praise, gifts, service that he would call beautiful. I want that, to leave the aroma of Christ everywhere that we go. Mary's pure and devoted worship of Jesus will be remembered. Did you catch what he said? Verse 9, truly I say to you, wherever the gospel is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in memory of her. That is incredible. You have these chief priests and scribes who were very happy to have their name recognized and to have their authority recognized. You have Mary who needs to say nothing but just wants to honor and respond to Jesus. And in a moment, we're going to interact with Judas. What Mary did was costly and public and judged by others, but it was defended by Jesus, commended by him on that day and throughout history. And it's beautiful. Now, I just wanted to give you a quick list of 10 things you can do that Jesus thinks is beautiful. Well, actually, that's not what I'm going to do. And instead, I want to read a second quote by Charles Spurgeon. You know, he's pretty sharp. We should have him preach sometime. Here's what Spurgeon wrote. There is a tendency within us to all look at this story and say, I love Jesus also. Tell me what I should do to show it. But part of the woman's great love was displayed in the fact that she came up with the idea to express her love for Jesus in this way. If there was a command to do this, it would never be that precious. Oh, cries the brother, tell me what I could do for Jesus. Nay, but brother, I must tell you, the better part of the whole matter will lie in the hallowed ingenuity of your spirit in inventing something for him out of your own fervent soul. That's awesome. You want to respond to Jesus. Lord, would you show me greater ways to identify with you? Would you show me greater ways to give you honor and blessing to tell others about Jesus? Lord, would you please prompt me to do the things that would bless you and speak of my love for Jesus Christ? It's beautiful. I want that. Mary's response, total reception. I'm 100% in for Jesus. Let it be. Lord, help us. Let it be. That's what I want. And then there's one more response, number 3, total deception. I'm all in until I'm out. Let's look at these verses. Mark chapter 14, verse 10. Then Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12, went to the chief priests in order to betray him to them. We've got an unholy alliance forming here. Judas sees an opportunity. Verse 11, and when they heard it, they were glad and promised to give him money. And he sought an opportunity to betray him. Tragic, awful. Jesus gave Judas an invitation to follow, and this was his response. Judas wasn't just a guy. Judas was one of the 12 followers of Jesus Christ, his disciples. He saw, he heard, he shared life with, he watched, he processed. He had the opportunity to know Jesus and to recognize him as the Messiah, the King. In the end, Judas was not committed to following Jesus. For Judas, Jesus somehow offered some upgrades, some improvements to how his life was before. And all this talk of a coming kingdom sounded pretty good. Maybe I'll get a role in this kingdom that Jesus is building. But in the end, Judas loved coins more than Christ. He wanted a place of power. He wanted a place of influence. And by betraying Jesus, he made a trade for something he thought was better. You know, it's really incredible. Jesus obviously loved Judas. He invited him in. They ministered together. But in the end, Judas made his decision. While he had been near and familiar with Jesus, he was ultimately unwilling to receive Jesus for who he was. Maybe he was looking for a Jesus and scenario. I'm not sure. Do you know, it's not enough just to know of Jesus. It's not enough to be in the proximity of Jesus or with the people who know him and follow him. It's a personal decision to respond to Jesus. I can't make it for you. You can't make it for me. You have to decide, who is Jesus, and will I respond to him by faith? Will I respond to him by following him? The reality for Judas was this, and let it not be true for us. I'm in until I'm out. The truth of that is, he was never fully in. He was going through the motions. He was doing some things. But when it all came down, he didn't follow Jesus, tragically. You know, it makes me think about, I've thought about this a lot before, a lot of times when we negotiate something, we work in kind of a contract basis, and I wonder if we're guilty at times of thinking, you know what, Jesus, I have decided that I'm open to considering following you. And so I drew up some terms, and these are some of the things that will be required. I need to have this by this time in my life, and that possession would be great, and I need my family to have X, Y, Z, and if you could provide security. You know, a lot of times I think we look to Jesus and we're like, man, he's making my life so much better. And Lord, here's the thing. I drew this up for you. So if Jesus, if you could just go to the X down here and sign off that this is what you'll do for me, that'll be awesome. But that's not what it means to follow Jesus. That's me coming to him thinking that somehow he's making my life better. Here's what it means to follow Jesus. Here's the contract we got to go for. It looks more like this. I will follow Jesus, and he doesn't need to sign anything. Where do I sign? To follow Jesus is to respond by faith. To follow Jesus is to respond with humility. Sadly, the chief priests, the scribes, chose not to. Mary, a beautiful depiction of a pure-hearted response to Jesus. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, you're worthy. What can I do in response to you? Judas, I'm in until I'm out. I want to give you just a couple more thoughts before we're done today. Think about this. These are all things you can learn right from the story that we just read. First is this. When you make much of Jesus, you don't need to make much of yourself. All the striving, all the wrestling, the scribes, the priests, Judas looking for these opportunities. And what happened? What happened? Disgraced, rejected ultimately, facing the consequence of turning away from Jesus. What happened with Mary? She didn't make much of herself. She made much of Jesus. And he met her and he led her. He's the Lord of all. A second thought is just this. Being all in for Jesus is our only hope. The longer I live, the more I look at the world, I can't put my hope in my plans. I'm not putting my hope in my goals and my accomplishments. Relationships are great. They're a gift from the Lord. They won't get it done. Our only hope is in Jesus. You're going to put your hope in money? You're going to put your hope in your health? You're going to put your hope in some semblance that I can control something? Man, no, it's clear we can't. All of our hope is in Jesus. He's giving us an invitation. We need to respond. And here's the thought, the third thing. We are moving closer to eternity every day. This theme just continues, and it's increasing in the book of Mark. Today, we're a day closer to eternity and the return of Christ. That truth needs to drive us closer to Jesus personally. Lord, you are who you say you are. Lord, I trust you as my Savior and my Lord. Lord, I want to give everything I could possibly give to you, to honor you. I'm trying to drive this into my own thinking, and I picked two things. I don't know. I hope they work. One of them is this, that I did this in the past. I'm bringing it back, that in letters and emails and correspondence, to remind myself, you know, instead of saying sincerely or whatever, I'm going to say closer every day. Because I want to live in light of the reality that I have the time that I have. And today is the day to honor Jesus. Today is the day to respond to him. The RSVP, the window is now. The other thing I did, I'll show you this little picture. This is a really high-tech calendar that you could buy at Target. And this sits on our kitchen counter. And it's very old school. It does not adjust automatically. It doesn't consider daylight savings time. And I kind of like it. I decided today, that's staying there, and I'm going to change that date personally every day. Why? To recognize that every day we're a day closer to the return of the Lord. And now is the time. If you're putting off responding, please do not. You know, I was researching this whole RSVP and the French origins. I found this paragraph. Listen to this. Sometimes people don't send an RSVP by the requested time because they're unsure and they don't want to commit to an answer. If this is your situation, it's best to be honest with the host about your situation. The only way they can help make accommodation for you is if they know you need them. I couldn't stop thinking about one more passage of scripture when I read that. And it's this. John 14, verse 1 says, Jesus says, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and I will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way to where I'm going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way?" Listen, loved ones, listen. Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Unbelievable. Jesus, the promised one, the Messiah, the Savior, he's the way. He's inviting you. He's inviting us, and we need to respond. Response is required, a decision of faith, a decision of humility, a decision of following Jesus, not on my terms, on his terms. Our prayer is this. If you've never made that decision for the first time, why not today? What would hold you back from surrendering your life to Jesus, responding to his invitation by faith? And if you've made that decision before, but you find your heart a bit cold, distant, my worship isn't fervent, I don't know if Jesus would call that beautiful or not, let's ask him to stoke the fires of our heart. Let's draw near to him. Let's sacrifice our time, our energy to speak and to worship and to praise and to serve Jesus. The imminent return of Jesus requires a personal response from me. And it requires a personal response from you. And I want to tell you, we're praying for you. And I got to tell you, we would love to hear from you. If you're like, "I want to talk to somebody about following Jesus Christ," would you let us know? You can text this number and just write the word "follow," and we will follow up. We would love to talk to you. We'd love to pray with you. We'd love to look at God's word to help you to see Jesus. Because responding to him is everything. And the time to do it is now. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you for the way it speaks directly to our hearts. Lord, would you find us to be people ready to respond to you? I pray for anyone, Lord, who's listening, who feels like they're too far gone. It's too complicated. It's too much. It is not, Lord, where we will turn by faith. You run towards the prodigal who's coming home. Lord, I want to pray for people who know you and love you. People like myself, Lord, that we do love you, but we want to give you the first and the best. Stir us up to live for you, to worship you. Lead us, Lord, we pray. You are worthy. You're enough. We worship you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Christ is my reward and all of my devotion. There's nothing in this world that could ever never satisfy. Through every trial, my soul will sing, no turning back. I've been set free. Christ is enough.
Thank you for joining us this weekend at Harvest Online. And thank you, Pastor Dave Lerner, for that powerful word. No retreat, no fear. We're not alone. There is absolutely no turning back because we've decided to follow Jesus. Maybe you'd like to receive prayer. We have staff and pastors that are standing by right now that you can just hit that button, prayer. We would love to be able to pray for you. And remember, as always, you are loved. Thank you.